And filling up some ice chests. So it's a good time, and I encourage everyone to sign up. The sign-up sheets will be out there. We are especially looking for someone to wash the dishes on Saturday, right? Cece, what time is that? Okay. Okay, so Saturday, not a ton of dishes to wash, but we do need somebody to wash them so that they're ready to go. It happens anytime after 6 o'clock, the dishes will be here and you can just wash those up. The sign-up sheet is out there. So we do look forward to this event. It is the number one fundraiser of the church, and it's a good time, right? You had fun. You had fun, you did. I know. Okay, open table volunteers are needed as always. We continue to serve over 100 people every week. This week we had a lighter week, so I'm sorry to say that we will be serving very delicious Mediterranean snacks after church this morning. So if you are interested in those, they are here and we are happy to share. We continue to thank people who've been doing some gardening. If you would like to do any gardening, there's flower beds to be spruced up around. We are still looking for at least one more church school teacher. If anyone's interested in that, you can see Deb or Rachel. The Social Justice Lending Library continues to be available for your use. Those are books that you can take home, read, share with a friend, bring back, exchange, whatever you need to do. There's some really awesome books out there. Global Bazaar has moved. I know you saw it. You can take a look and shop to your heart's content for all the fair trade items. So those are all items. That means the person who made it or grew it got a fair wage for the work they put into it, which is not always the case with everything we buy. So it's nice that we have those options. We do thank everyone who did work this week. We saw lots of vacuuming, gardening, mowing, lots of things getting done. So we thank everyone who participated in that. At this time, I think I got all the announcements. So I'd like to invite everyone to meet and greet those around you. If you're at home, you can type something in the chat. If you are here in worship, you can stand, meet and greet your neighbor, and pass the peace of Christ. May God be with you. Hey Siri. Hey Siri. Okay. Again, good morning. Pastor Alyssa and I are so glad to be here with you. I would like you to join with me in the call to worship. Look at the heavens. The day and night declare the magnificence of God's creativity. Let our words of praise be acceptable to you. Amen. We will now sing hymn number 25, O God, our help in ages past. Thank you. people who'd like to come on up, to come on up here, and we'll have just a minute to talk about some things. Come on up. Good morning. Good morning. Welcome, welcome. This morning I wanted to talk about words. Okay? Just words. Words can make things happen. Do you believe me? Yes. Words have power. Words have power to make things happen in our lives, to do stuff for us. You believe that? Okay. Hey, Siri, what is the United Church of Christ?
The United Church of Christ is a mainline Protestant Christian denomination based in the United States, with historical and confessional roots in the Congregational, Calvinist, Lutheran, and Anabaptist traditions, and with approximately 852 churches.
I just said something and the phone started talking. Did you guys hear that? I called on Siri, right? Okay. There are other things we can do. I practiced this morning. I can tap on my phone. I can say, Google, play me a song, and it'll do that, right? So words have power to make things happen in our lives. How about with not technology things? Can words have power? They can. I can think of a big one. How about please? Right? Stuff happens when you say please, right? Okay? Stuff happens maybe when you say thank you, right? Words can have power when you say things like, I forgive you, it's okay, I love you, right? Those are all powerful words, right? I can think of other, oh my gosh, David, you look so great today. You look so great. Power, right? Can we feel the power? Now, our kind words have power for good, right? Our unkind words can have power for what? Not so good, right? Okay? So what God asks us to do is to always use our words for good, right? When we say things to other people, if we use kindness, if we use love, we're using it in God's way. If people are using their words to bully someone, there's power in that, right? But it's not the good kind of power, right? So what we're asking people to do, what the Bible lesson's going to be about this morning, what everything boils down to is we are called to use all of our skills and powers for God's goodness, okay? Good words, happy words, good actions, right? And I know you guys think about those things, and I know you guys are forces of good in the world. Would you join me in prayer this morning? Dear God, thank you for bringing us together. Thank you for giving us opportunity to use our words, hear our voices. Even if we're small people, our voices have power. Our words are powers of goodness. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. This morning we are going to read from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 8, verses 27 through 38. Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi, and on the way he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist, and others Elijah, and still others one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Messiah." And he sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, but turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and for those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Here ends the lesson. May God transform understanding into action. Amen. To say that we have another gospel text full of scandal would be an understatement. But it doesn't scare me away. These kinds of texts are actually my favorite. Mark's gospel is known for its unique style of writing. Each of the stories in Mark are brief and punchy, which tends to emphasize the drama and scandal of what is going on in each text. Mark wrote to elicit a response. The details don't matter, just the facts. And the facts were laid out as a way to shock and awe people into paying attention, because a lot of what Jesus did was pretty shocking. As we know as readers, centuries after Mark wrote, though, sometimes when it comes to Jesus, we need the details. We need a little bit more to help us understand. But Mark doesn't freely offer that to us. He just gives us the juicy truth, shocking us into attention, and then leaves us to discern the rest. It's like Mark gave us the bare bones script that we then can take and modify to whatever context we are in, while leaving the important pieces, the truths, the scandal, the shock, in place. It's quite brilliant of Mark, really. He focuses on the drama, we focus on the creativity. He focuses on the facts, we focus on application. He focuses on truth, and we focus on understanding. So this particular gospel has three movements, if you will, each one a little bit more scandalous than the last. The first is the campaign trail check-in. The second is an unpleasant revelation about the future. And the third is an impossible choice. Individually, each movement is shocking and bear some new information for the disciples about who Jesus really is. But together, these three movements tell for the first time the gospel story. Pared down, these texts tell the disciples what is going to happen to Jesus and what their life after Jesus will look like. But gassed up, these texts pose impossible questions to us about life and theology and spirituality and identity and on and on and on. I often like to take the route of paring things down to make them simpler when I cover texts like this, because it's sometimes just easier to digest and understand. But other times, it's good for us to focus on the tough questions about what makes living a life of faith so challenging. So Jesus is introducing that concept to the disciples this morning. So in honor of that, we're going to go there this morning. We're going to look at some of the hard questions about the life of faith. So first, let's look at the three movements, the first one being that campaign trail check-in. So Jesus and his following disciples have been traveling around for a while now, teaching, performing miracles, really introducing the world to Jesus's ministry. So at this stage in their travels, Jesus wants a status check from his followers. How am I doing? What are people saying about me? And their response is to be expected. The disciples share some of the common titles people have used to describe Jesus before understanding the full scope of who Jesus is. Some think he's just a prophet. Some think he is Elijah back from the dead, and possibly even John the Baptist. These are valid answers, typical answers, but of course, none quite hit the nail on the head. These answers paint Jesus as probably the closest thing to the Messiah that the crowds could come up with. But without that triumphant political overthrow and ascent to the throne that they were expecting. Could it be their beloved John the Baptist? Or their just prophetic, messianic voice in Elijah? But because Jesus had not done the thing that people were expecting and waiting for, Messiah, Savior, was not yet their answer. However, Jesus' disciples knew him better. They had more of an inside look into Jesus' ministry. So when Jesus asks them, "Who do you think that I am?" they answer correctly. They say, "You are the Messiah." But Jesus sharply tells them never to out him as the Messiah in public. Why, you might ask? It's a fair question. Well, that brings us to movement number two, which is the unpleasant revelation about the future. In his answer, Peter likely had the same image of a political liberator who was finally going to come set Israel free from tyranny. And to Peter and the other disciples, Jesus's teachings and his miraculous power and generous love seemed very consistent with that. Peter was still likely expecting that kind of thing out of Jesus. They were just waiting for that to be true. Knowing Jesus personally did not keep them from seeing Jesus as that kind of Messiah. But Jesus was not that kind of Messiah, as he was about to reveal to them in this second movement. Jesus wants them to speak nothing of Jesus as Messiah because their Messiah was actually facing a certain future of humiliation, torture, and death, especially at the hands of a religious and civil authority that they wanted to be freed from. So this is a 180 from what it seems that a Messiah would mean to them. The Son of God, it changes Messiah from the Son of God from a name of triumphant power, one that's worthy of being followed, celebrated, and renowned, to one of suffering, rejection, and public humiliation, one no one would want to claim as their leader. So Jesus urges the disciples to be careful with this title in the wake of such a revelation. The information that the disciples just received was certainly information that would shock and awe them. This was information they were going to have to just take a minute to process. Because this, for them too, was an upset to the image of the person that they had decided to dedicate their whole lives to follow. So that brings us to movement three, because Jesus isn't done there. The third and final movement is an impossible choice. There is a tense exchange between Peter and Jesus that shows that Peter is having a hard time with this revelation. And Jesus decides just to make it all the more complicated by now moving into what life of the disciple of this kind of Messiah would look like. What it means to follow a suffering Messiah. Jesus says that discipleship with Christ requires denying oneself and taking up one's own cross. In other words, also being willing to suffer, face torture, and lose your life if that's what is necessary. This means that to follow Jesus, you have to be willing to lay down everything in order to have that triumph that they're so desperately seeking. Jesus is presenting to them that in his role as the Messiah, as the one to come and save them, he must suffer and die. But in order to be faithful to this Messiah, and to continue reconciling the world back to God, you must also be willing to suffer and die. And so to Jesus, life and freedom and peace comes at a cost, a big cost, if you will. And so now this proposition into a life with Jesus, the disciples aren't sure that's what they signed up for. Sure, they about gave up everything and left all the people that they loved to follow Jesus, but the job description didn't say anything about torture and death. In the three movements that we just went over, Jesus quickly and swiftly reinterpreted not only Jesus as Messiah, but who we are as followers of this Jesus, and what discipleship and faithful living looks like. For the disciples, this idea of self-denial was probably new. The idea of sacrifice was definitely new. And as we well know, Jesus didn't come to uphold any kind of status quo. And the disciples probably knew that and were expecting that to some extent. But what they learned for the first time that day is that for Jesus, even upsetting the status quo won't be status quo. Their leader was not the leader they expected. And life of dedication to that leader will not be what they had expected. Freedom and peace will not come at the cost they had expected, and freedom and peace will not be what they expect. Jesus, in one single conversation, upended everything they thought they were getting into. And I don't think the disciples were at all prepared for the paradoxes they were introduced to that day. So the disciples are shocked. But let's leave them there in their shock and focus on what we might be feeling right now. Maybe not shocked per se by these revelations as we know as the gospel story, because we've read this, we know this, we know how the story goes. But perhaps we are still scandalized like the disciples are. Because truthfully, I'm not sure that we hold all the paradoxes of the Christian life together so well either. Time has not necessarily benefited us that way. It can be hard for us to hold two truths together, especially what seem like two contradicting truths, which is what the disciples had to hold in this interaction with Jesus. Confirmation that yes, he was the Messiah, but the bombshell that he was going to be tried and murdered. These two things don't compute when they're put together. Each of these two truths challenge the other and cancel the validity of both claims. And I think we do that a lot ourselves with some of the truths that we're presented with in the Christian life, perhaps even some proposed in this passage. Like, I think the one that a lot of us will struggle with is this command for self-denial, of denying oneself for the sake of the gospel. With something troubling like this, we could just tuck it away and totally ignore it. We could assume it's just Mark's shock and awe writing style, and Jesus didn't really mean it the way it's written. Or we could let it do harm by assuming that means God maybe isn't as merciful and loving as we had originally thought. Or we could do the hard work of exploring, of practicing holding the tension for things that are uncomfortable or the things that don't totally make sense to us. We could dig in and do the hard work that Jesus is requesting in this passage. We could be ready for God to present to us the flip of our status quo. And that really is the self-denying work that Jesus is referring to here. Jesus asking the disciples and us to open ourselves to being surprised by what God is doing and to be in awe of how amazing it is that we get to be a part of it. One of the clergy groups that I'm a part of started this discussion around what it means for pastors to self-deny. You know, pastors are sort of expected in our culture to serve at the mercy of their congregations and in addition can be held to kind of a higher, holier standard. And so they're expected to be above reproach and maybe even model the sacrificial living that Jesus is asking for in this text. And so the discussion that ensued in the group is about what that really looks like in practical everyday life, especially now in our modern context. Now, I'm sure this question was asked just to generate discussion in anticipation of this text coming up in the lectionary. But I also caught tones in the discussion of the way that this last year and a half, the pandemic and everything that happened in this last year and a half, has changed how pastors themselves thought about this question. There were more specific examples, more signs of burnout, and less willingness to acknowledge the demand for self-denial in this text. I think the easy conclusion to draw here is that the pandemic and everything pushed pastors to their limits. and they now no longer knew how to faithfully answer this question. And it's not just pastors. There have been a lot of professions and people that have had to pivot and bend over backwards to back-breaking extent just to keep our communities flowing. And so the question of what does it mean to self-deny hits different when you've been sacrificing and forsaking yourself for so long, there's literally nothing left to give. When you officially crack and you don't even have any more self to deny, what does it mean to self-deny then? And is that really what Jesus, who cried love and compassion and wholeness, meant? And so that's the context for the discussion in this group, and it was powerful to see people speak to their experience and really question in raw and real ways what on earth that really means. I think that we've also been, for so long, led to believe that there are only two options. You either love Jesus or you love yourself. To love yourself meant you loved sin, and therefore you could not possibly also love Jesus. And to love Jesus meant that you fell in love with all that is good, and so you could not possibly love yourself because you are all bad. This is what has led to, I've talked with so many Christian people my age who describe this as creating a culture of shame. That as humans, we are all bad and God is all good. And there's this dichotomy here. So in order to commune with God at all, to have any relationship with God, you had to deny yourself because you were not good enough to be in relationship with God. And that mindset comes from passages like this, where the shock factor and the intense demand for discipleship asks us to set aside any needs that we might have because those needs are innately bad. That those are selfish and they get in the way of our ministry. And by the looks on some of your faces, I think that you agree. And maybe it's this shame that we feel when we read a passage like this that keeps us from walking into the deep ponderance of some of life's hardest questions, especially around spirituality and faith and what it means to be human. Maybe we're afraid to seek the answers to those questions, especially like this, because the answer might ask too much of us. So we'd rather just walk away. And maybe that's what the disciples felt that day, that the discomfort around upsetting the status quo was just too much, that they had already been asked to sacrifice too much. Self-denial is too scary and damaging. So this text has presented the disciples and us with the realities of a faith full of paradox, of holding two things together that just don't add up, with a faith that will be nothing like we expected. This presentation of the gospel shows that the path to discipleship is rocky, rough, and will require a 110% effort from us. That as a follower of Jesus, we will likely to be mocked, ostracized, and bruised, and in all likelihood, we will never be the winners of society. And in addition to potential social humiliation, we're also going to be intellectually challenged all the time, because nothing about this faith is easy to understand. We are going to screw it up and get it wrong all the time. So that's a big ask. That's a big commitment. This text has shocked and awed and made the disciples uncomfortable, and I bet it has the same effect to us now. It is still intellectually challenging. It is still complicated, and it is still asking 110% from us on our journey. But let me pose this idea that is what this self-denial looks like. Not the self-deprecating, I am bad, I am unlovable, shamed-based stuff we've all been taught, but a willingness to trudge into difficult and uncomfortable territory. The willingness to stay firm when things get hard. the willingness to fight for the underdog, the willingness to not always have the answers and be willing to admit when you don't, the willingness to go in even if it's scary, the willingness to be a disciple of a leader who was tortured and killed for your freedom and your wholeness. And accept that for what that means, even though we know it's not easy and it's not comfortable. What if that is self-denial? What if you can love Jesus and love yourself? But what if knowing that loving Jesus is hard work means you know it will require sacrifice, and you choose it anyway? We are being presented with a decision. This text is doing more than just shocking and awing us into realizing there are paradoxes in the Christian life. This text is demanding we make a choice about the kind of life that we want to live and the kind of relationship that we want with God and with each other. This text highlights the complexities and does not shy away from saying, hey, this isn't going to be what you thought it was, and it's going to be hard. It's not going to be easy. But Jesus is presenting a crossroads to the disciples. This is the reality. This is what it will cost you. It's going to cost me my life. So what are you willing to sacrifice? And every time we come across this passage, we are being presented with the same decision, that this is what this reality cost Jesus. And so what are we being willing to sacrifice? This is a decision we're now faced with every single day. Deciding to go with faith every single day is self-denial, is discipleship, is pleasing to God and restoring of relationship. One of the comments in that discussion I talked about earlier was, there was one that stuck out to me the most, and it was this one, and I want to read it to you in closing. It's honestly amazing how much of our spiritual life is about discovering over and over again that we are loved, and that so much of what blocks that love for us is fear. Fear of being rejected, being ignored, being unlovable. If anything is problematic, it's our own insistence on categorizing all the things that we need to do to ensure that Christ loves us. What is the highest command? To love God and to love our neighbor as ourselves. Self-denial is overcoming our fears and choosing to remember that God does love you. So much so that Jesus had to suffer on our behalf. Self-denial isn't nailing yourself to your own cross, but choosing to love God, love your neighbor, and love yourself. And to be prepared for all the shock and awe that is bound to come our way on this life of discipleship, and deciding to be a disciple anyway. Amen. Please rise in body or in spirit as you are able. We will say the words of our church's mission statement together, which can be found on the wall here. Responding to the living God with a progressive voice and working hands, we are called to feed Christ's community in mind, body, and spirit. We will now sing together. We will be turning to number hymn 96, Son of My Soul, O Savior Dear. Thank you.
We are now going to enter into a time of prayer together. I invite you to pray a prayer along with me, calling in your hearts and minds any of the needs or requests or joys that are on
our hearts. We will close together saying the Lord's Prayer. There is one listed in your bulletin. There's also one listed on the front page of the hymnal, but you are always welcome to speak or silently speak along with us, whatever prayer is on your heart. Please pray with me. God of love, you gave your only Son so that he would undergo great suffering for our sake. Seeing this great suffering, we believe that you understand the sufferings of the world and our own suffering. Believing that you have walked in our footsteps and that you have lived through trials and tribulations, we offer our prayers to you. We pray for wisdom, that we can communicate effectively with love, shalom, and compassion, and strive to live in connectedness and understanding. We pray for courage so that we can live out our faith, giving witness with our words and actions that you are the Messiah. We pray for the will to take up the cross and to follow wherever you may lead. And we pray for love, your love in us, so that we can live with the intentionality to know each other by name and to have the deep relationships that you want us to have with you, with each other. Through Jesus Christ, who lives in unity with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever, we pray now together. Our God, who is in heaven, blessed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Save us from the time of trial, for yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We now have a time to give of our tithes and our offerings. You are invited to bring your gifts forward. The offering plate is here in front of me. This can be financial tithing, but as you heard this morning in announcements, almost equally as important to that financial tithing is some of the needs that we have for volunteers around the church and at Fallisburg this weekend. We are a small but mighty church. We are busy, busy, busy. So we value what you can contribute both in time and talent just as much as your tithes. And so this is a time just to, Deborah's gonna play us beautiful music. So it's a time for us to just ponder the gifts that we want to return back to God out of the abundance that God has given us. We will then close this time singing Rising and then singing the doxology together, which is also listed in your bulletin. Thank you. Men, please pray a prayer of dedication with me. God of wisdom, may this offering serve as a powerful witness to this world in need. Guide us as we administer the gifts that you have given us for the building of your kingdom in Jesus Christ. Amen. We will now remain standing and we will turn to hymn number 588, Let Justice Flow Like Streams. To remain standing as we sing our common commission together. You are also all invited to stay and join us for coffee hour after the service. It sounds like we're having Mediterranean foods, which is more like a lunch in my opinion, but I am here for it. So you are welcome to stay. We are so grateful that you joined us for worship this morning. It is so wonderful to continue to see so many faces and to just know that we are in this work and in this faith together. So, let us sing. Peace to love and serve. We go in the name of Christ.